dentoalveolar fracture, we'll deal with it superficially because we've got a lot of other things to deal with, right? It is limited to the teeth and supporting structure of the alveolus, causes our traffic accidents, falls, epileptic seizures, sport injuries, and even industrial accidents, right? So this is Ellis and Dewey's classification where you got class 1, class 2, class 3. Now, most of these fractures would be dealt with more in detail in conservative and in periodontia. What is important is that when you got a class 5 fracture over here or something that has got impacted, we need to immobilize it, right? We cannot say that I'll refer you to a periodontist or a conservative person. If you do not have the facilities of the specialist or a maxillofacial surgeon, then one needs to stabilize it. And how do you stabilize it? I'll just show you. There, before you stabilize it, you do the clinical examination, history, vitality test. And when you see the x-ray over here, right? When you see the x-ray over here, you can see the fracture of the roots, right? This is the way you stabilize it. Use of splints, use of arch bars, okay? Or horizontal stabilization. Now, this depends on how much it is acceptable to the patient, because sometimes, you know, the patient who is in a public, who is a public figure, may not accept this. So we can use something called as acid edge composite splinting, which is rigid enough, but not too good. But yes, it gives you reasonably good results, right? Otherwise, the best way of having a proper dentoalveolar fracture reduced and immobilized is with an arch bar. An arch bar is also helpful when you got a fracture of the mandible or the maxilla, right? So what is the stabilization period for dentoalveolar injury? You got the mobile tooth, where 7 to 10 days, displaced teeth 2 to 3 weeks, sorry about that. Displaced teeth 2 to 3 weeks, root fracture 2 to 4 months. So that means we need that much time to keep the arch bar in place, right? And of course, if there's an alveolar fracture, where there's a bony fracture also, it is 4 to 6 weeks, okay? Now we come to the mandibular fractures. It is said that mandible to the maxillofacial surgeon is like what a canvas is to an artist, right? So this is the sort of things that, you know, one, we are more comfortable working on the mandible, right? Now these are the mandibular fractures that one can appreciate, and there is nothing better than a CT scan to give you the best results, okay? So the classification of fractures, we are going to deal with two classifications. There are thousands of classifications of fracture of the mandible. Not just the fracture of the mandible, we have fracture of the condyle also, right? There's so many classifications. So basically, for the paucity of time, we are going to deal with the basic ones, that is the Dingman and Natwigs classification, which we use it very easily to communicate with other people. So this is according to the anatomic part, okay? So you have the condylar process, the coronoid, the ramus, angle, body, and symphysis. It is as simple as that. So you can just say the patient has suffered a fracture of the body of the mandible, right? And of course, you've got the alveolar fractures or the dentoalveolar fractures. The second one is the Kragers classification, where it is an open fracture that is compounded. Now, here comes the trick question. An examiner would usually ask, you have a fracture of the parasymphysis of the mandible in a 21-year-old, right? Is it an open fracture or is it a closed fracture? You always need to say that it is a compounded fracture or an open fracture, because it means it is open to the external environment. External, what is external environment? Anything that is outside the soft tissue or the mucosal coverage. So if there is a break in the canine region, obviously, it has got exposed to the oral cavity and the oral fluids, right? Then it can be comminuted where there are more than two fractures, green stick, where there is one cortex that is fractured. Usually, that is seen in children. You've got the pathologic fractures because of any pathology that is there, bony pathology, where the bone has got very atrophied. Complex fractures, multiple fractures, that means more than two bones are involved. Atrophic fractures you see in the geriatric age group. Direct fractures, if you remember my third slide, where there is a blow to the chin and the parasymphysis fractures on one side and the condyle on the other side. So what is that called? It is called as a contrecoup fracture, right? And then lastly, you got the impacted fractures. Impacted fractures are usually seen when the mandible, I'll show it to you in one of my subsequent slides, where it gets pushed upwards or the maxillary segment goes downwards, right? So the third classification is according to the biomechanics. Now we call them vertically favorable or unfavorable fractures. Now, unfortunately, in the patient, you cannot put your head inside, but this is the general schematic given. This is according to the muscle pull, which is there. So you have got, when you look from the top and it gets displaced inwards, so that is called as unfavorable fracture, right? Similarly, according to the pull of the muscle, that is the masseter muscle, you got a horizontally favorable fracture because this will go opposite to the line of the muscle fibers. And it is a horizontally unfavorable fracture if it goes along the fibers of the masseter muscle, right? Now, this is what I was talking about, impaction, right? The condyle gets fractured and the mandible tends to, the ramus of the mandible gets shortened, and accordingly, the fulcrum, which should be here, gets shifted to the molars. And when this happens, there is a gagging of occlusion or an open bite, right? So there are two causes of open bite in maxillofacial trauma. One is when the condyle gets fractured, and second is when the maxilla gets impacted downwards, which we'll see later, right? One very important thing, and especially one needs to note this in pediatric fractures, is that a high condylar fracture, which happens within the capsule of the temporomandibular joint, right? When there is a fracture, what happens is that there is bleeding. And when there is bleeding, it can undergo remodeling, because blood is a pluripotential tissue. It can undergo, after it organizes, it can undergo into formation of bone. So what happens is that there is a resultant ankylosis, especially in a young patient, may not happen in an old patient. I'll come to the reasons later. Right, it can happen in a young patient and it rapidly undergoes reorganization, and ultimately the patient ends up with bony ankylosis. And I think Dr. Gardis spoken about it earlier. Right, so this is the slide that I was talking about. If there is an adult fracture, condylar fracture, what happens is that you see that it is usually extracapsular, right? While in a pediatric patient, the periosteum is very thin, the cortex is thin, and there is a high periosteal activity over here. So if there is hematrosis, obviously it is going to get reorganized and get formed into an ankylotic mass, right? So this is something that one should keep note, especially from the viva point of view. The indication for presence of mandibular fracture, the patient would have pain. Now, sometimes what happens is that there is a blow, whatever, because of violence or trauma or whatever, right? The patient may not notice the fracture, right? The teeth may occlude properly. But what happens is the moment the patient tries to bite, the patient gets pain. There could be sudden dislocation or malalignment. There is numbness because you have the mental nerve which is present over here. There could be bleeding, the slide I'll show subsequently. Swelling in this region. And of course, there could be dyspnea if it is a bilateral condylar fracture, right? Bilateral parasymphysial fracture. Okay, so this is what I was talking about. A pathognomic feature of fracture of the mandible in the dentate region is called as the Coleman sign. Now, why do you see the Coleman sign? The Coleman sign is because, you know, the when there is fracture, there is bleeding, and the tissues in the sublingual region are very lax. So what happens is that the RBCs and the blood, it tends to flow in that region and can cause a hematoma. This is a typical feature which you see over here, right? There is derangement of occlusion. That means the teeth don't intercuspate properly. There is a step deformity over here, and there is restricted mouth opening. Restricted mouth opening can happen in cases of fracture of the angle, okay? So how do you evaluate? We evaluate the patient completely, right? You come to the management part of fractures of the mandible. So what would you want to do? Okay. Now, basically, the first thing is, like I said earlier, you establish the airway, control the hemorrhage if it is there. And one thing one should keep in mind is that when you get a patient of extensive hemorrhage, in the facial region, one should not worry too much, right? You can just put a pressure pack. If it is from the fractured bone, just try to do a temporary stabilization, okay? Do the suturing of the soft tissues, right? And then you can manage the patient. However, if the patient has got some abdominal hemorrhage or thoracic hemorrhage, one needs to be very careful. Stabilize the other injuries, evaluation of the damage to the vital structures, and then lastly, you repair the fractured bone, okay? So this has to be a perfect balance between form and function. Now, what the patient wants is to, there are two things that the patient usually wants. The first is the patient gets restored to the pre-morbid condition, and more importantly, that the patient needs to eat, mastication, right? Hum kamate kyun hain, so that we can eat properly, and that is what the patient wants. The patient needs to chew on food, and that is how we restore the form, right? So, very importantly, one can do a reconstruction using the open rigid and internal fixation. So what is done for, be it a fracture of the mandible or the maxilla, the first thing is we need to restore the height, the width, and the projection. These are three things that are very important, right? So the basic management would be airway, I spoke about it, circulation, pain control, soft tissue management. If the patient comes, I am primary center, you need to manage the sutured, lacerated wound. I recollect an incident when I was in the government dental college and my house officer came and said that she admitted a patient of fracture of the mandible. Then I said, can I see the patient? And when I saw the patient, I was shocked because this patient was someone who had got hit with a sword by his tenant in the night. And what happened was that it had got the patient had a major laceration, a very clean laceration from the outer canthus of the eye, splitting the upper lip, splitting the lower lip, and then the mandibular fracture was a very tiny incident over there. So one needs to evaluate the patient properly and then do it, right? So then stabilization using intermaxillary fixation, infection control, and antibiotics.